Hi everyone, welcome back. Thank you for being with us. I would like to announce the next speaker who was here apparently last year at the exact same spot, at the exact same stage. So if you were here last year, then you're having a deja vu moment. Please give him a warm welcome.
Thank you. Can you folks hear me all good? How are you doing today? It's rainy outside. All right. Anybody knows what this picture is? Have anybody seen this? Sorry? Sorry? NASA module. Okay, it's a module, yes. Yeah. Specifics, anybody? Nope. So this is actually the fastest man-made moving object that was made. It's called as Parker Solar Rover, and it travels at a speed of like 635K kilometers per hour. That's a fast thing. And my talk is about performance. Anybody used any of this here? OK. Can you spot the odd man here or odd thing here? Yes, that's correct. We have new thing that we need to cater for. Right. And anybody knows the significance of this date? As a web developer, you should know. Yes. Sorry? Yes, awesome. That's the day that it is dead. And I hate seeing the screen. So putting all this thing together and so many more stuff, things like janky sliders, having low performance stuff, and last but not the least, this thing has made me to do this talk. And this talk is about high performance web applications. Welcome to the talk. I'm Sendil. I'm originally from India. You can see it from me. And I currently live in Netherlands. I'm an engineering manager at Uber. If you are wondering what an engineering manager is going to talk about coding, I still do it. I'm sorry. And I right now learn Zig-Lang. Anybody is learning Zig-Lang? Anybody knows about it? OK, we have one person. That's great. I'm also a Google developer expert on web performance. So I asked this question in the Vova. I really loved that app. It was really great. And there are like a few interesting things that came up. I'm going to cover a few of them here. I reworded some name. There was code metrics. I renamed it to Lighthouse metrics, because what is that? And there is somebody who asked for saga pattern. I'm not sure I will cover that, but we can talk about it outside of this room. So let's start from the basic stuff, right? Like just to make sure we are aligned over there. I hope most of you are web developers and used browsers before, right? Yeah? OK, cool. So you have browser and server. The moment you hit an URL, the URL actually redirects. It goes to a cache and looks for, like, hey, where do I have to connect and get the information? If the cache doesn't have that, it goes to the DNS server. And then it makes a TCP connection, TLS stuff. And then it goes and goes to your server, gets a response for the request, and throws it back. Predominantly, the first thing that happens is HTML, if you're doing a web application. And then your browser processes it, and then loads and shows the content for you. And this time that it takes for your browser to kickstart a request, it goes to a server, comes back, it's what is called as time to first byte, or TTFB. And I'm going to talk a lot of things like this. So I'm just giving a warm alert here. Like a lot of jargon terms will be used. I'll try to cover most of them. I'll try to give explanation of what each and everything is. But let's try to run towards there. So TTFB is time to first byte. The average human interaction span is like 0.3 to 3 seconds. The first slide, or the first couple of slides, is where you have determined whether this guy is worth listening to or not. And that is the average attention span for any human inside. And as a browser, when you give this link to the browser, like you give your index.html and it has this kind of things, the first thing browser looks into is these things. It looks for a script. It looks for a CSS file. Anybody who loves CSS here? OK, we have a few folks. We need to talk about it. And you can also have images. And browser actually optimizes its own content and then figures out, like, these are the things that I have to go and download. So it goes ahead and downloads these extra things, JavaScript, CSS, images. And this entire bundle is what we call it as critical resources, or the things that stand on your critical path for your application to load. And that's how your websites work. So TTFB, why it matters, actually? Like, why the time to first byte matters? If you can throw your first byte faster, you can get your application to work faster. So that is the main reason behind it. And if you just take a look at it, like, there is like HTTP archive. If anybody has visited that website, you might have seen like a lot of statistics about it. And as a person who loves number, I love to go and figure out what are the statistics there. And it sees like there are 71 average requests that is done by every single page in web application. This is average. So there are apparently some application just uses 2 or 3. There are applications who use hundreds and thousands of it. So you're making 71 average requests, which means the number of resources on your critical path is 71, which increases your time to first byte. What you can do to optimize it, you can go for hosting. If you have a very good hosting server, and if you have a good backend technology, not PHP, I'm not talking about that, then you can have faster hosting. And your content delivery network, CDNs, are also your friends. You can use content delivery networks to make sure first byte is coming faster to your application. The first thing for improving TTFB, you have to reduce the number of things that you're putting in your critical path, like the amount of JavaScript, amount of CSS that you're going to download in your first file. Try to reduce it. You can improve your TTFB much faster. So you can use caching. You can avoid multiple page redirects. And you can use service workers to improve TTFB. The next thing, Core Web Vitals. Anybody knows about Core Web Vitals? Uses it in your application? No one uses Core Web Vitals. Anybody using Lighthouse? Okay. 1, 2. Okay. Okay. Then my topic is not basic. Okay, it's basic. Yeah. So the first thing that you have to know in Core Web Vitals is like contentful paint. The moment your browser receives all those things, all those images, all those JavaScript, it tries to lay out the content. It tries to draw the content into your web page. Something like this. And your web page gets loaded at the first, and then it opens up and draws the first information that it received, and then it continuously paints everything on top of it. So it layouts everything together. And this is what we call it as first contentful paint and the largest or last contentful paint. So this is where, like, when your browser is done with FCP, your browser can actually allow you to interact with the website. So you can actually start scrolling down the second screenshot. And then at the last one, your application is fully ready, and everything that you want your customers to see, you have everything ready there. So your time to first byte is the first thing that reduces, that increases the time delay. And then the resource load delay is basically all your resources getting downloaded. And the load time is basically like how fast you can make your application look or come back in that browser screen. And that is what all about. Like, you need to shrink all the steps further so that your application looks faster and it also works faster. So for example, this is if you just take an Apple website or any website, you could see this much amount of data that is getting transferred. So and on average, every website, they have like 1,712. And all the web experts, if you go and talk to them, they'll say like 170 kilobytes. That is the maximum you can do. And this is like 10 times more than that or 100 times more than that. So you need to optimize, make sure your bundle size is smaller in order to make everything better. How can you do it? You can split. You can split your application into multiple pieces and make sure every page or every component that you're driving is splitted correctly. And you just have to load what is needed for you. Like, if you have an application that does 1,000 different things, but your user always focuses on one thing, just load the thing that is needed for that one thing, not for the 1,000 different things. Anybody using Redux for their blog websites here? No, right? Thank God. Yeah. There are some people who are using Redux for their blog websites. And what you can do, like, you can optimize it using preload and lazy load. So there are concepts like where you can tell a browser, hey, load this beforehand, or load this, like, do not load this when I'm loading this particular thing and things like that. So you can use this concept called preload or lazy load on the link tags. And the Cloudflare actually announced this early hint announcement, which basically what it does is, like, first, your browser goes to your DNS, and then it downloads all the information, shows it to the client, which is your browser. And then what it does is, like, it also pushes all the extra things that is needed for that. Like, it preloads all the data that is needed for that and pushes it over here, and which is very fundamentally meaningful, and it increases your loading capacity because you're pushing all those contents you're expecting what the users should do. So you, in order to improve your FCP or the first contentful paint, you have to minify your resources. You have to, like, make your resources as small as possible. Eliminate anything that blocks the render. perfect things are like your cookie consent and all those things, you eliminate and put it outside. And you preload and prefetch things to make sure everything is preloaded and prefetched as you need your application uses. And the next thing is like cumulative layout shift. Anybody used this thing before? Have experienced this thing before? Yeah. So this is a weird thing. It's like if you're e-consumer, if you're building an e-consumer e-commerce website, and you have this kind of thing in your website, it kind of like breaks your users' trust, right? The perfect example that I could see is like ads. When you put an ad placeholder or add something like that, it kind of like loads aftermath. And once it finishes loading, it kind of like makes all your content to shift. What you can do better there, you can have a minimum height. Or you can just say like, OK, this place, I'm loading it beforehand, and I'm going to put a content over here. So you can have placeholders, shimmerings, and loaders, which could help you out. You can avoid mutations and re-rendering that happens. You can optimize the JavaScript that in order to allow not to have janky animations. And you can, few concepts that you can do is like you can add dimensions for your images. Like if you're loading an image, you can say like, OK, this image is going to be 200 x 200. My image size is going to be like this. You can have web fonts, or you can also like use animations without layout shift. And the next thing that you have to look into is interaction to next paint. So which is basically like the perception of like how interactive your site is like. When a user clicks on something in your site, how can you make the perception much more better? So far, what I've seen is like how can you make your application load faster? But this one is like how can you make or make users believe that your site is faster? So when you click on something, the response has to be immediate. If it like has more than 200 milliseconds of time gap, then your response is too slow and users get fed up with it. So if you just take a look at this network request, your first contentful paint opens up. And when the first contentful paint finishes, your time to interaction actually is ready for there. And then your first input delay is basically like when you're first clicking on the button, the very first input that you're doing is what we call it as first input delay. And you have to make sure all these times are smaller so that your application is perceived much faster. So you can avoid things like long-running tasks, avoid using timers, and avoid interaction overlap. These kind of things will help you to remove all those interaction problems that you're going to have and release it forward. And in the world, like we have around like 19 to 20 million websites that are audited so far. And out of that, 45.7% of the websites have better core web vitals. These are the three functionalities or three things that we saw. But there are a lot of work that we need to do to make it 100% good website. So your first contentful paint should be like less than 1.8 seconds, which is basically your users should be able to see what they have on the browser within 2 seconds. There should not be any changes in the browser structure in the terms of like how the application is laid out. And when a user clicks on a button or when a user like tries to do something on your website, they should have less than 200 milliseconds in terms of like interaction. If you are doing all these three, your application is faster. And the one way to measure it, you have this lighthouse, which is in your Chrome tab. You can also put it in your CI/CD pipeline, which helps you to measure what is happening across multiple places. So try to measure, optimize, and measure everything as you do it every time. So this can be in the production side. There are multiple sites that can help you, but Lighthouse is a tool that is at our convenience, we can use it. And there's been like timeless of studies that we have done that shows like performance actually improves business. The lower the FCP, lower the time shifts that you have, or lower the interaction you have, higher the conversion of it. Just like minimizing like 10 seconds or 10% of your performance, you could get more benefit in your customer business out of it. So that is basically why performance actually matters, and we need to focus on performance more. And there are like more than 92% of the websites have this poor UX that will cost them sales. So if you're working on anything that requires sales or acquiring customers, ensure that you have like 92% of performance hike. And the next thing is like we have seen what is Core Web Vitals. That's basically it, which helps you to measure how your application works. And the next thing is rendering. Rendering is also one of the fundamental stuff that defines how your application works. And we can do a lot of things. before we jump into rendering, anybody, like, how many of you are using Angular? Okay, few. React? Few. Vue? Yeah, we have few. Anybody used, apart from static rendering, anybody used, apart from CSR and SSR, anybody used, like, hydrations and everything? Okay, a few, okay. All right, so we will look what this rendering is all about, how it helps to make the perception of your application looks better. The first thing is, of course, client-side rendering. It's basically nothing but your traditional web application. So you have your application which delivers what you want. So if you put it in a timeline, you get a request, you send out a request, it goes and builds a bundles.js, and then it gets a bundle.js, which is your JavaScript file, technically, and then it renders the app. It fetches other files, which is your JavaScript, CSS, images, and all those things, and then it loads them together, which is your traditional web application. And at this point somewhere, your first contentful paint will happen. And then your JavaScript lays out things, composition happens. During this entire time, your application is blocked, which means your users cannot do anything. Your users cannot touch anywhere. Your users cannot, like, click on any buttons inside there. And once it is finished, that's when the time to interactive starts. So this is a point where your application will be starting. So in this case, what you have to do is, like, you have to shrink this area. You have to shrink this area, and then you have to reduce the bundle size. That would help you to do. And in terms of CSR, a few things that you have to note is, like, you're fetching data and you're doing everything. For example, in your React, inside your use effect, if you're putting a client-side call, then everything happens over there. And something that you can optimize it, again, like, you can split, you can preload, lazy load. And if you have application cell, use CSR for that. And then static rendering is basically your block sites. Here, everything compiles, builds at the compile time. So at this point, you get data, you get the request, but everything is built. Your client or your browser, sorry, your server actually spits out HTML response completely. And then you just load everything there. And the moment it reaches, your FCP starts, and then your TTI is also shrinked. So if you compare this with the previous one, your time to interactive is much faster, so you can make your applications much faster. So you have faster TTI. It's very good for SEO if you want to optimize for search engine. This is very good for that. The build times are much higher. Do not use static rendering for your dynamic site. And the pre-rendering is something that you can also use it over here. Next thing is server-side rendering, which is typically the same as static rendering. But in this case, it generates HTML, and then it also uses JavaScript on top of it. So here, you get a page, you drive all those things, your application is done, which is server rendering. And then you get all this JavaScript and all those things, of bundles, and everything is loaded. Now your application is ready. So if you put it out, your loading starts, you fetch data, you use the third-party library, you generate an HTML. All these blue things happen on your server side. It is not happening on your browser. So which means, like, you can optimize it faster. And once that is done, you just send out an HTML. The moment you send out an HTML, it's not ready for any interaction, because JavaScript is the one that puts an interaction, right? So you hydrate all those contents over there, and then your application works. So hydration happens in that particular scenario. So in terms of SSR, it's much slower. It's good for SEO, but again, like, the server cost is going to be huge. And in SSR, you just want to make sure your hydration is better to ensure, like, every application works properly. And then we have this optimized rendering techniques, which is basically that next level, what you can do, how you can combine things. And that's where suspend comes into picture. So in suspend or progressive rendering, you get an application. Here it gets a bundle.js. And then it renders. Again, you see FCP and TTI is much closer, which makes it much more faster to render the application. And you just go ahead and download chunks of it. So you're basically, what you're doing is, like, you're chunking your application and loading just chunks of it as and when it is needed. And for example, if this is a site that you want to load, let's consider this React syntax for here now. You have a header, sidebar, and post and comments. Post gets all the posts for you, and then comments gets all the comments. So header, sidebar, and footer, you can make it as a client-side rendered components. This is like hybrid fusion, right? So you can make them as client-side rendered components. Post and comments, you can make it as an SSR. So in this case, in post, you go and do fetch post. And once you finish the post, You go and give that ID to the comments and ask them, like, go and get all the comments attached to that post. And that's how it works, right? So what you can do is, like, you can wrap those comments inside Suspense. So now you have two different calls that can happen asynchronously. It need not be synchronous as in previous case. It can happen asynchronously, which makes it much more simpler. You can do the same thing with Angular using provide client hydration for the components of the module. So you can make sure your application renders both the server-side render components and the client-side render components together. So in this case, you need not wait for fetching. You need not wait for hydrate, wait for finishing of the hydrate and things like that. As and when you get your browser gets the data, it can just show the content as it needed. So here, the code splitting, it makes you to do code splitting. You, again, have to reduce the bundle size. And you can also do on-demand loading whenever, wherever it is needed. There is something called Islands architecture, which also makes it much more simpler, which is kind of a progressive rendering. And in React world, it's getting much more famous. You can also try using Islands architecture if you want. And React also came up with this new concept called server components. This will also help your application make better. In terms of server component, you can define a server.js, which lives on the server. So the React component that actually runs only on the server, it will not go to the client. So what you can do is, like, it can connect to your database, it can connect to your file system, or it can connect to any API on the backend, on your server, and then it generates a HTML. Since it's closer to everything, it's much faster. Rather than you go and connect with multiple different places, it just connects from your server, which makes it much more faster. And if you take a normal example here, if you're just using normal client-side component, you have to download this 1,200 kilobytes of information on the client. And the client does the hard work for you because it generates a marked from the markdown file, it generates a HTML for you. So it, everything happens on the client here. But when you make it as blog.server.js, everything happens on the server, which makes it much more efficient. Because on the server, you can do all sorts of optimizations to make it faster and just throw the content that is needed. So if you're using server components, it will give you smaller bundle size. You can cross-import multiple things. But you have to think about, like, how you're going to handle user events on a server component. But it's also one way where you can make your application much more faster. So this is an overall view, like, as you go from server to client, how does everything change? Your SSR is basically your Gmail or Hacker News, and everything is built on SSR. But CSR likes all our apps, like 90% of the application that we derive, SPAs, are using CSR. And the next bigger or next worrisome part of your application is images. Anybody tackle multiple images in your site? Few? How do you optimize it? Do you use anything to optimize the images? Sorry? Image format, OK. What else? Sorry? ImageX, OK. Yeah, ImageX is great, yeah. And you can use fetch priority for fetching priority of the images. So if you have 15 images in your HTML file and that lies on the critical path, your browser actually optimizes them. So what your browser does, it looks 15 images and says, like, OK, this person is not doing something correct. All I'm going to do is, like, I'm taking the first 5 images or first 7 images based on your server or based on the client that you're using, first 7 images as the higher priority images, and I'm going to download it. And your application does that for you. The browser does that for you. It's insane. But on the other hand, you can also configure it. You can say fetch priority. There are 3 values. You can say, like, high, low, and auto. With this value, you can make sure your image is properly getting downloaded using the perfect fetch priority that is required for your images. You can also do easy lazy loading and eager loading if you want. This is another way of doing it. This is not widely supported, but this is also there. And if you put lazy loading in Chrome alone, you can get enormous benefit. So here, what happens is, like, instead of loading everything together, it loads only what is essential to load. And it approximately, there are like 1 megabyte of images that is used in average across multiple websites. So if you are using that, try to optimize it. And this is one of the amazing things that I've seen in the Apple website. They are kind of like downloading all the images. They have around like 107 images that is getting loaded on that single page. And none of the images, like, more than 500 or 600. There are a few 600 or 700 KB images. None of them is like more than 1 megabyte of image size, and which is great because they are using fetch priorities here. And if you take a look at it, like the sequencing of the images, the waterfall diagram, it kind of like 5 or 7 together, and then it kind of like shifts to the next tick. So that's how it works, and make sure you're using that. If you are using image CDN, ImageX, and things like that, you could get a lot of benefit out of it. In image CDN, you can transform, optimize, and you can do all sort of things that you want for your images, which makes it much more easier for you to handle images. And there is this format called AVIF, which gives you higher percentage, like 31% of savings, if you're using this format, which is just a format change, and your image CDNs can use that. When you're using images, think about properly and using sized and responsive images. Use image CDNs if you can, and use fetch priority. That will also help you. And memory leaks is also another thing that you have to fix for your performance. And one of the things that we always do is like JavaScript is memory managed. Nobody is going to worry about it, right? But memory leaks are a real thing in JavaScript, and that also makes your application hog up. Few things that I've seen, set timeout and add event listeners. You need to do this to ensure like application works better. If you're allocating them, try to remove them. There are long-running functions, which also makes your application slow. And things that actually eventually kills your main thread. If you're doing something, try to remove it. So overall, performance optimization is not an end goal. It's going to be a continual process. You have to do it at every place of your application. And you can optimize your resource delivery by prioritizing BF cache or using unused resources. And then you can optimize your CSS by removing images from CSS, CSS-in-JS, and then layout shifting animations and things like that. You can avoid long rendering tasks. And you can optimize third-party resources using pre-connect or DNS prefetch. In terms of Angular, since I've seen like a lot of people said Angular, I've added this slide. You can also use a lot of things like TrackBy for your list manipulation, use web workers. You can use lazy loading and stuff like that inside Angular too. Yeah. And if you are really, like this is not an answer for everybody, but if you really want to do better, you can also go for WebAssembly. That would increase your application performance. Use profilers. They are helpful. And the perception matters in terms of performance a lot. So with that, and then, yeah, use the platform that you have, which improves your application performance better. And that's it. Thank you.
Does anyone have any questions? Well, if anything pops to your mind, he is on Hoover and he answers his questions really thoroughly. And you can find him anywhere outside in person to ask him anything you want.